We welcome you today to our fourth lecture by Mr. Jeffrey Say, curator, art historian and lecturer at LaSalle College of the Arts. Through the past few sessions, we have learned about the purpose of art, the way to look at a work of art, and we have also covered a short introduction on sculpture. Today, Jeffrey will be talking about the very interesting subject matter of contemporary art in all its forms. Paintings, sculptures, performance arts, and installation art, video and conceptual art. This talk will help us to understand how contemporary artworks go beyond technical skills. Contemporary art belongs to the realm of thoughts and not just reality. It is about thinking and not just representing. In other words, contemporary art finds inspiration in the idea that the idea behind art is more important than its appearance. Having the principal goal to push the public to think. And so we face artworks of all kinds, from Damien Hirst's infamous Sharp Preserve to Ai Weiwei's 1001 Fairy Tales, where he brought Chinese tourists to the Documenta in Germany. These are the kind of artworks that provoke us to think. Hence, we look forward to this very interesting talk and discussion, and we hope that by the end of this lecture, we'll be more knowledgeable and appreciative of the art of our generation, that is, contemporary art. We hope you will enjoy this session. Thank you.
Okay, yes, that's the title of my talk today, The Staff Shark and Other Curiosities. Can we ever understand contemporary art? Okay, now maybe you think that, you know, I got the title wrong or something, because there is the kind of perception, right, that contemporary art is accessible. Okay, it can be easily understood, right, compared to, let's say, pre-modern or traditional art or even modern art. Okay, and that's because it's the art of our time. Okay, it's the art of the here and now. But this is not often the case. This is not often the case. And I suppose if you look at the art that is in this gallery, now do you consider the art that you see to be contemporary art? Yes, of course. Right, of course. I mean, there are several reasons why you say that. Okay? Because there are artworks that have been created probably in the last few years, okay, or at least in the last decade or so, right? So that's what makes it contemporary. Okay, but the art that you see around here in this gallery, you know, are still, I would say, quite accessible, right? And something that you can understand and appreciate. However, there are some contemporary art, okay? Now, you can understand or appreciate the art that you see around this gallery because you recognize their forms and you recognize their content. Okay, you can still see paintings and sculpture. Okay, but some types of contemporary art are not, you know, are quite impenetrable, I would say, and inaccessible, right? And that's because they use materials and forms which are unconventional, okay, that you don't recognize. Okay, and you'll see some examples in this talk. For example, okay, before that, let me just, you know, I think it's good to set the term contemporary in context, okay, and what it means, okay, and how it's distinguished from, let's say, a traditional or pre-modern work. Okay, these are the work of the old masters, right? I suppose you can, you know, date that back all the way to the cave paintings, you know, at Lascaux and other sites, right? Right down to the 19th century, where the subject or subject matter, right, played an important role in art, okay? And where realism, okay, was also highly valued. And then you have modern. Okay, modern art works from the early 20th century to about the 1960s. And modern art is was dominated very much by abstract art. Okay, so some artists come to mind, you know, including, of course, Picasso, right? Then you have the abstract artist Kandinsky, you know, and then in America you have Jackson Pollock. Okay, so their works can be classified as modern. And then contemporary. Okay, now this word contemporary itself, I mean we are familiar with it. Okay, but sometimes we don't quite understand, okay, what it means, right? And some people just refer to it as art from, okay, refer to contemporary art as art from the 1970s to the present. Okay, I suppose that's one way of looking at it. Okay, some people date it back all the way to the beginning of pop art, right, with the works of Warhol and with the works of Lichtenstein. Okay, where artists try to bridge art and reality, art and life. Okay, so pop art, I suppose, can be seen as, you know, the beginning of contemporary art. Okay, this is a very simple definition of contemporary, a term used to refer to recent art and which is considered of its time and spirit. Okay, art of the here and now, right, of the here and now. Right, that's, I suppose, the common usage of the word contemporary. Okay, but if you look at it in a more theoretical sense, okay, the word contemporary is sometimes used alternately with, okay, this term called postmodern art. Okay, actually, they should not be used, you know, in an alternative manner, but often they are. Okay, but so postmodern art is a term used to distinguish it from modern art. Okay, postmodern means what comes after. Right, it's actually a theoretical term. All right, because what happened in the 1960s is that, you know, some people, you know, like philosophers, they began to question, okay, the dominant and established belief systems like Marxism, like organized religion, okay, like white or male dominance, okay, and you know, and all these so-called hegemonic belief systems think that they have the answers to life, okay, but philosophers at that time from the 70s, from the 60s began to think that, you know, life is, you know, it is there are no simple answers to life, okay, because when you look at society itself, okay, society was beginning to change, okay, and society itself was becoming more fractured, more diverse, more chaotic. All right. So I suppose from the 60s, 70s onwards, there was a more open attitude, for example, towards social, ethnic, racial, sexual differences, okay, and also towards you know, environmental, ecological issues. So if you bear that in mind, you'll see that, you know, contemporary art, it actually reflect that changing outlook of life. Okay, and so contemporary art is, I would say, more inclusive, more diverse. Okay, deals with many issues, right? And also it looks at society. Okay, it looks at society in a very, I would say, skeptical, right? And also in a very insecure way. Okay, so when you look at contemporary art today, it's what you call, you know, anything goes, right? Anything goes. Okay, there are really no boundaries. Now, have you, you know, gone to a gallery or museum, okay, and you know, talk to yourself, or sometimes, you know, telling that to your friends, you know. Is that art, right? You call that art? My five-year-old can do it, okay, right? It's con art, you know. You know, contemporary, con is short for contemporary, right? It's con art, okay? Or it's rubbish. Okay, I remember once, you know, I think at LaSalle itself, at the gallery, and one of my colleagues, I won't mention her name, you know, she was a she did an installation work, you know, which consists of, I think, items of clothing, you know, clothes. I think she wanted to deal with the theme of migration, right? And I think someone walked in and asked whether that's a storeroom. Okay, anyway, Now, this work, Fountain by Marcel Duchamp, okay, was, if you look at the date, made in 1917. Okay, but if you look at much of contemporary art today, okay, owes its influence, in fact, to Duchamp, right, to the ideas of Duchamp, to Duchamp's own approach towards art making. So Duchamp was in many ways, and his works also were in many ways, you know, ahead. He was ahead of his time. Okay, ahead of his time. Okay, because he was really, you know, through this work, he began to question, okay, the nature of art, the definition of art, right, the boundaries of art. Okay, he began to question notions of originality in an artwork, authenticity, okay, and even authorship. Right, because according to Duchamp, it's the viewer, the person who sees the artwork, that completes the picture. Right? Okay, so his ideas are very contemporary, and he's often regarded as the father of conceptual art. Okay, so this work here uses a found or ready-made object. Okay, it's actually a urinal if you don't recognize. Okay, he bought it from a hardware store, turned it upside down, signed with a fictitious name, okay, R. Mutt, okay, and presented it as a work of art. Okay, not surprisingly, it was rejected, right? And but of course, later on, it became it's probably the single most influential work of the 20th century. But of course, we don't know whether Duchamp meant this as a prank or not. You know, so that's a question that's still unanswered, because later on, he went back to playing chess, which was actually his first love. Now, this work was displayed in the last Biennale, right? I think that was in 2011. And Singapore is going to have its fourth edition in October this year, right? And, you know, if you want to view, you know, works that are, you know, cutting edge, that goes against the mainstream, that uses unconventional materials, forms, okay, you go to the Biennale, right? Because it's at the Biennale where, you know, you find artists, right, who produce works that really are, or, you know, that go against the mainstream, right? And this work, you know, when I saw this work, of course, I was there, and, you know, when I entered, it's a large space, right? Okay, but all you see are this, okay, you know, what do you call that, large scale, sort of architecture-like structures, okay? And it was done by a German artist, Michael Butler, okay? And he actually designed this machine that you see here to churn out modular elements, okay, which he then put together in such large scale, ad hoc, right, architecture-like structure. Okay. And, you know, I must admit that, when I first saw this, I was a little bewildered, I was baffled, right? And if you are the kind of person who tries to look for aesthetic quality in a work, you will be utterly disappointed. Okay. But, you know, with contemporary art, I suppose, the idea and the concept is sometimes more important, okay, or paramount, or the idea or concept is something that, you know, conveys the artist's intention, right, rather than the aesthetic quality of the work, right? And a work like that, like this, you know, leaves it open for interpretation, and I think perhaps that's what makes contemporary art so interesting, but at the same time, also so frustrating. So I don't know, and this is an example of installation art. Okay, we're going to talk about installation art towards the end, right, of the talk. Okay, installation art where it makes use of, the entire space, right, and where, the work itself is site-specific, right, and the artist himself said that he liked this space. This was at the old Kallang Airport, okay, for its very industrial, raw look. How about this work? Now, this work was done by a certain Jeffrey Say and Saleh Japar, who is a prominent artist in Singapore, who actually is also my colleague at LaSalle. And now, this work was shown at the Nokia Arts in 2001. And Nokia Arts at that time was like the Biennale, okay? It was the most prestigious art event in Singapore. But you might be thinking to yourself, you call this art? Okay, what about creativity? Because what we did was just we are like Duchamp, you know? Okay, we use found objects. Okay, can you see on the first showcase, right? That's your ordinary mortar and pestle, correct? Yes. And and on the extreme right is a pranakan, you know, kamcheng. Okay, and then. On top, you have quotations from the writings of scholars and and philosophers. Okay, like for example, this is not a work of art, right? And quotes like that. Okay, so where's the creativity in this? Okay, but here, we focus more on the idea. Okay, the idea, and our main idea for this work is how museums represent culture, right? How museums represent culture, okay? Sometimes, museums like to objectify, right, certain cultures, okay? Rather than understanding those artifacts or objects in their cultural context, okay? Okay, anyway, that's the one and only time that I became an artist, okay? Right. Okay, I'm actually an art historian. Certainly not an artist, okay, but we will see, again, the definition of art, has really evolved as well. Okay, what is wrong with contemporary art? Okay, the images I'm going to show you, right, can be quite disturbing and offensive. Okay, you have been warned. Now, this work was shown, it was a work by a Danish artist. Okay, and what this artist did was that he had some blenders and he placed some goldfishes in the blenders. And viewers would be challenged to switch on the blender. Okay? Right. So, I suppose. I'm not sure about the idea for this work, I mean, whatever it is, it's like, you're killing a life. Okay? And it happened. Okay, one viewer, right, on it, and two goldfishes died. Mm. And of course, the police was called in.
No.
Yes, and they wanted to charge the museum. It was shown in a museum, in fact, right, with animal cruelty. But I'm not sure about the outcome of this work. I mean, the outcome of the case itself, the charges. Okay, but the museum director was adamant. He says that, this is, freedom of expression. Okay. Yes, and maybe the artist, he wanted to give the viewer the power of life and death. Right? Okay. It's in your hands. Some people say he's sick. Oh, we already have two people leaving. Okay, never mind. Maybe I shouldn't show more of these images. Huh? Okay. If you think this is disgusting, huh? there are more to come. Okay. Man eats dog. Okay. Now, this particular artist, right, Mark McGowan. He's a performance artist, right? So this is what you call performance art. Okay. And for this performance art is normally performed in front of a live audience, right? Normally, okay, not all the time, right? And for this performance, right, it shows him eating meatballs, or should I say dog balls, okay, made from corgi. Corgi is a type of breed, okay? And this particular performance was a protest against, how the monarchy, the queen and the family, right, treated animals. Okay, because it This was done in protest against the beating of a fox to death by Prince Charles. Okay, so the artist here wanted to, you know, this meant this work to be a protest piece. Okay, so he made, I think, 3 meatballs, right, and ate them. And he said it was so disgusting, right? He actually spit out 2 of the meatballs. About this, okay? A Chinese artist, you know, the Chinese, I think, are the most, you know, radical and extreme, you know, performance artists. I mean, if you talk about performance art, okay, the most extreme examples can be found in China, okay, or are to be found in China, right? So here you have this artist, you know, photographing himself, cooking and eating a stillborn baby, a fetus. Now, again, I mean, at least you have the reassurance to know that it might just be a fake photograph, okay? The fetus might not be real, okay? But we have to give the artist the benefit of a doubt, okay? That he's actually biting into a real fetus, okay? But he's challenging things. He says he wants to challenge the space between morality and the law, okay? That little space there, right? Okay, we are not sure again, but you know, this is really cannibalism. And you can, oh, yes.
Yeah, that may be called a revolutionary, that's rebel, the rights of fallen artists.
Oh, right, of course, of course.
You can give so many other names, but why is this fallen artist?
Yeah, you see, I mean, okay, I mean, he was already an artist, okay, before he did this work, okay? So I suppose that gave him the license, you know, to do works and for those works to be recognized as art. Okay, and also when the work is displayed in a certain context, right, that work becomes a work of art. Okay, right. I know, it's not an easily answered question, right? Okay. Ready for more? Now, if you know, have you seen that big baby, the white baby in Marina Bay, right? Somewhere in Marina, I've not seen it in person, okay? But a big baby sort of floating weightlessly above the ground, okay? The white baby. And that's a work that's done by the same artist, okay? The UK artist, Mark Quinn, okay? But he's more famous for a series of self-portraits. Nothing wrong with that, self-portraits, okay? But self-portraits made out of the artist's own blood, okay? And he has made it a point to create one of these self-portraits, once every 5 years. Okay? In a sense, to document his life, you know, right? To see how much he has aged over the years. Right? And if you compare his earlier ones and the later ones, yeah, you can see that, you know, age really catches up with us. And for one of these so-called self-portraits, he used about 4 to 5 liters of his own blood. But he never got into serious difficulty, right? Or serious medical problems. Okay, because he had to consult his doctor, and the blood was normally taken over a period of 5 months. Yeah, not all at once, you know, 4 to 5 liters. That's, okay? Right. Now, if you look at just a picture alone, okay, you would think to yourself, this is, you know, a work that follows tradition. This is just a work of the crucifix, right? It's a religious imagery. But then when you look at the title, Peace Christ, right? And you say, wow, you know, it's offensive, right? I mean, how can you have a title like that, you know, for on the surface, what seemed to be a religious work? It is a crucifix. Now, I won't be talking too much in detail because I want to save that for my, you know, my next talk, right? Which I'll be talking more about this work in detail, right? But this work was a work done by Andrea Serrano. It's very controversial. Now, the word peace there, of course, you know what, you know, peace is, right? Not in the sense of peace off, you know, but your urine. Okay, so what Serrano did is that, I mean, I can't deny that it's, you know, as someone described it, it's a mysterious and beautiful image. Okay, what he did was that he submerged a plastic crucifix in his own urine, okay, and photograph it. Now, why he did that? Okay, there's a story to it, right? And again, in my next talk, I'll explain this. Okay, and it infuriated many people, right? You know, I think at one of the Senate meetings, you know, senator stood up and you know, he called this work, you know, a blasphemy. So you see that artists are beginning to use new materials for their work, right? Their own urine, blood, okay, etc. And of course, excrement of feces. Okay. Now, this was a work done by Chris Offley. Of course, you know, I didn't state the exact materials, but mixed media, okay? Included in that mixed media is actually elephant dung. Now this is again a religious imagery, right? It depicts the Holy Virgin Mary. Okay, and it was done by an artist called Chris Offley. Now he was one of those artists who belonged to the very notorious, you know, Young British Artist Group. Okay, of course led by Damien Hirst. Okay, and you have artists like Tracy Emin, you know, and other artists within that group. And in 1999, okay, they came together for an exhibition called Sensations, right, in which this work was included. And the exhibition traveled to New York. Right, and I think the exhibition also included a work by, you know, a work which shows a child murderer, but using the handprints of children. Okay, and that work was very controversial. It was vandalized. Okay. Now, coming back to this work, right, so this works. This exhibition was shown in New York, and it created, again, a controversy. If you look at this work carefully, you can't see it here. But if you look at it, close up, okay, you'll find that you know. Where's the pointer? Okay, never mind. Okay, can you see those collage images like butterflies? You know, when you look at those images close, you know, from close up, you'll find that those are actually cutouts from pornographic magazines. Okay. And how about the elephant dung? Okay, that's, if you look at the left breast, okay, or around that area, okay, there's a lump. Okay, and that lump is the elephant dung. Okay, and of course, you know, again, you know, many people consider this work to be blasphemous. Right? I mean, you know, you have dung on a religious imagery. Right. And Rudolph Giuliani was the new mayor of New York at that time. Right. And it was shown at the Brooklyn Museum. Right. And he threatened to cut off all funding to the museum. Okay. And I think the museum appealed. And, you know, as usual in America, you know, they invoked the First Amendment. Right. It's freedom of expression. And the museum won the case. And, you know, and the mayor couldn't shut down the show. Right. Or nor cut funding to the museum. But, you know, Chris Offley, you know, in his defense said that, well, I'm of Nigerian descent, you know. And in Africa, you know, the elephant is a revered creature, right? Okay? So I suppose the dung has certain, you know, kind of sacred, you know, properties. Yes, good question. That's right. Okay? And in fact, if you look at some of other of Chris Offley's work, you know, yeah, okay, some of them are, you know, equally sexual as well, right, and offensive, yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Okay, as I said, that's why, you know, this work, you know, sort of, you know, created so much controversy. Right. But again, you know, there are always supporters of this work, of work, you know. So you normally have your detractors and your supporters, you know, of contemporary art. I suppose, you know, when you look at contemporary art, you know, you have to understand that contemporary artists are trying to challenge the mainstream. Okay? Right? You're trying to challenge the mainstream. And they're always coming out with works that are very unconventional. Right? Using materials that have not been used before. And that's how art keeps evolving, I suppose. As I said, my role today is to help you to understand and appreciate contemporary art. But whether I succeed or not is another matter. Okay. At least for the works you see here, right? Not the works, let's say, you see in this gallery. Okay, works like this. Okay, so this work inspired my title. Okay, the title of my talk. Okay. Is Damien Hirst. Now, whether it's captured or not, you know, that's debatable. Again, I won't go into that debate. Okay, but people call it a sculpture. But this is again an example of what you call installation art. Okay, and it's a work by Damien Hirst, who is today's richest living artist. Okay, he's a British artist. Right, and what he did for this work was that he commissioned a shark, the famous shark hunter Vic Hislop, okay, the Australian shark hunter, okay, to hunt a tiger shark. Okay, and I think he paid like something like £6,000 to £8,000 for that shark. That's about it. Okay, and the whole work only cost about £50,000. Right. And what he did was that he got this shark and he suspended this shark in a glass tank. Okay, I must say that, you know, there's some aesthetic quality in that glass tank, right? So he framed the shark in this glass tank, okay? And suspended it in a liquid of formaldehyde. Okay, you all know what, you know, formaldehyde is a kind of liquid used to, you know, preserve, okay, biological specimens. And he titled it, right? You know, to me that's quite a poetic title, right? The physical impossibility of death in the mind of someone living. Right? As if it's not enough just to grapple with the work, eh? You have to grapple with the title. So what is he talking about here? Okay, what's the whole meaning of the shark in the tank? Okay. And that's not the only sort of animal, a work involving animal that he did. He did quite a number of his whole series involved, let's say, you know, there's one where you have a mother cow and a calf, right, sliced into half, okay? And there are also work which involve pigs, okay? So this is part of his repertoire of works. Okay, but for this particular work, okay, now, it seemed that you really, in order to perhaps to grasp the meaning of this, or even to appreciate, you have to see it in person. That's where you come face to face with the tiger shark, right? And that offers you what they call a visceral experience, okay? Something that you'll probably never experience when you see it here on the slide, okay? Because Damien Hirst's work normally plays on the theme of death and mortality, right? So in coming face to face with the shark, you're actually also, okay, encountering, thinking about your own mortality. Right? So that's perhaps the artist's intention. And as I said, the work costs a total of about £50,000. And in 2005, okay, the work anyway was bought by, I think, Charles Saatchi. Right? Charles Saatchi was the one who collected many of the works of the young British artists. And in fact, he was the one responsible for their success. And in 2004 or 5, okay, this work was sold to the hedge fund billionaire, right, Steve Cohen, for $8 million. Some say it's $12 million. You know, there's this book called $12 Million Stuff Shark. Okay, I would highly recommend it to you if you want to know the kind of internal dynamics of the art market, even the conspiracy of the art market, all right? Read that book. called The $12 Million Starve Shop. It's been out a few years. That's a must-read book. Okay, must-read book for contemporary art. Okay, the other book, must-read book for contemporary art is 7 Days in the Art World. Right? Okay, 7 Days in the Art World. Okay, where you have this person who goes, you know, right? Sorry? She's a reporter. Okay? And she goes around the art world, okay, like auction houses and, you know, to the gallery, right? And she gives you an inside view, or insider's view. Now, this work, I think, beat them all, right? Okay? Right. It's a work by Martin Creed. And this work, in fact, won the Turner Prize. Okay, the Turner Prize is Britain's highest award. Okay, and he has a prize money, I think, right now, I think it's £25,000. And this work won. And what's this work about? Okay, it's merely an empty space, you see there. I think, I don't know whether it's a gallery, but it's an empty space. Okay, as the title suggests, the lights going on and off. So every 5 seconds, you have the lights going on and off, and that's it. That's it. Okay? But as I said, you know, I mean, responding to a question by, you know, an earlier question, that, you know, artists also have their, you know, their supporters and the detractors. And of course, the jury who selected this need to say something in defense of the work. Right? Now, this work created a huge controversy, and it questioned even the value of the Turner Prize. Because the Turner Prize, you know, has a reputation for, granting the top prize to the most controversial and unconventional work. And so, you know, you can see what the jury said, right? They admired the audacity, okay, in presenting a single work in the exhibition, noted its strength, rigor, width, and sensitivity to the site. Okay, and his supporters also said that, well, perhaps the artist is trying to make a commentary about the clutter and materialism of today's life, you know? So what you have is an empty space, okay? Right, but you have critics who say that this has gone beyond a joke, okay? And what does the gallery text say? You know, sometimes people can write a whole essay on that work alone, you know? Or even a whole book, okay? Right? So the content of this work is almost nothing. Yeah, that's true. Okay. And it makes a comparison, for example, with John Cage, 1952 work, 4 minutes, 33 seconds of silence. Have you ever seen those work? You can catch it, I think, on YouTube, where you have, where John Cage has, you know, collaborated with this pianist, David Theodore. Okay, and David Theodore comes to to the piano, opens it, sits there for 4 minutes, 33 seconds, and does nothing. Okay. But if you know John Cage's work, right, he has a new approach to music. Okay? I mean, and his works are very cutting edge, you know, in the way he approaches tonal qualities and all that. Okay? And in fact, in that particular work, you know, the nuances made, you know, by the audience, you know, right? Someone maybe coughing, you know, all that becomes part of the work. Right? Okay, so we need to understand that, I suppose. So why are we afraid of contemporary art? Okay, I have a work here, of course, you know, you all love this work, right? Oh, sorry. Okay. Now, this is a work, of course, by the Renaissance master, Sandro Botticelli. Okay, and it's called The Birth of Venus. Okay, one of the most famous paintings in Western art. Okay. And now, for a work like this, I mean, Renaissance work is not exactly easy to understand, okay? Because you have to understand, for example, the symbolism used in the works, etc. Okay, but if you don't understand the kind of mythology, okay, the subject, it's still fine. At least you can appreciate the work at other levels, right? You can admire the skill of the artist, right? The detail of the work, the meticulous, drawing, right? So I suppose for, you know, for pre-modern or traditional works like this, right, it's a little easier to understand. Okay, and we are not so afraid, you know, when we look at such works, because we can appreciate it, okay, at many levels. Now, critics of contemporary art, or con art for short, okay, say it is difficult and demanding. Right? But having, you know, if you say it's demanding, in fact, all works of art are demanding. Right? Okay, it sort of demands our intellectual sort of faculty in trying to understand it. Okay, it communicates, right, and it demands a response from us. Okay, so I suppose, you know, almost all works of art are demanding in that respect. It is what they call opaque. Okay, there's this word that's used, opaque, meaning that it is resistant to straightforward interpretation. But then again, you know, it's interesting because it then leaves the work open to interpretation. Okay, so contemporary art is open-ended, right? Okay, and you know, you can interpret it in any way you want. Okay, as long as it sounds convincing. Some people call it con art. That's why I say it's fraudulent. It's a confidence trick, right? You know, this particular artist has no skill, right? That's why, you know, all he does is conceptual art, right? No skills in painting or drawing. Okay, it's an easy way out for that artist. You know, you have some artists who don't even do their own works. They get the assistants to do them, right? And artists who come to mind include Damien Hirst, right? And also Jeff Koons. Okay, these two are among the world's richest living artists. Okay, it's confrontational, definitely. Provocative. But then again, you have to understand, it's always very important to understand the intention of the artist. Okay? Why did the artist want to make that particular work controversial or provocative? Right? Well, some artists simply want publicity, you know. Bad publicity is even good. It's good publicity, right? Perhaps. Right? And it can be beguiling and frustrating in equal measure. Okay, you can come out of an exhibition, you know, scratching your head, okay, wondering whether the thing you saw there is art. Right? It's obsessed with, you know, firstly artistic spectacle, okay, and I think contemporary art really attracts by simply its skill, its configuration, you know, and its size, right. Is, you know, some contemporary art are simply monumental, right? And contemporary artists want to create what they call a spectacle, right? Spectacle. I think one such work that I have in mind, okay, was shown here a few years ago. You know, remember Chai Kuo Chiang's, you know, Chinese artist, his work involving wolves, okay, the wolf pack, right? That's a spectacle, yeah. Okay. And personalities, okay. Today, artists have become what they call brand names. Okay, brand names, right? Okay, they are like any product you buy, you know, like Louis Vuitton, you know, Gucci, right? You have your Damien Hirst. Okay, I want to buy a Damien Hirst, right? I want to buy a Jeff Koons. Okay, so they become like commodities, like products. Its critics say that it lacks whatsoever in skill, creativity, originality, and aesthetic quality. That's, I can't deny that. Okay, you have seen examples, you know, in this talk so far. But as I said, is that the artist's intention? Okay, what is the artist's intention? Okay, perhaps, you know, the idea, as I mentioned, or the concept of the work, right, is more important than everything else. And of course, it's over-commercialized and over-hyped, no doubt. Okay, the auction market and all that will tell you that. Right. You know, everybody's trying to get into the bandwagon. You know, the contemporary art bandwagon. You know, right? And it is getting worse today, in fact. Correct, Su Ping? Su Ping runs an art gallery, right? Art commune in Bras Basah. Okay. But he carries his gallery carries more or less Singaporean works, right? Okay. Specializes in Singaporean works. Oh, sorry. Oh, right. Okay. Done this. And contemporary art gets a lot of media attention. And I think it really thrives on media attention. Okay, as I said, you know, perhaps the more controversial the work, the better. Because as I said, you know, bad publicity is still publicity. Right? Okay, and some people also feel, you know, the critics feel that there's a kind of a conspiracy happening. What is termed an unholy alliance. Okay? Between different sectors of the art world. Okay, when I mention the art world, it means museums, galleries, curators, art critics. Okay, I'm not sure about art historian. I'm an art historian. Okay, so I'm not into any conspiracy. Right. Okay, there's a kind of conspiracy. Okay, and the conspiracy, for example, can result in an artist, you know, becoming, for example, famous overnight, okay, or famous within, you know, a short span of time, okay, or a particular work, okay, breaking, you know, prizes in the auction house, right? So certain things, you know, can be manipulated, especially, for example, the price of artworks, okay, and as you know, the prices of, you know, contemporary works are astronomical, right, today. Okay, who are the stuckies? Okay, of course, you know, contemporary art have their critics. And one of their critics, unfortunately, just died recently, called Robert Hughes. Right? Robert Hughes, I think, did this BBC documentary called The Mona Lisa Smile. You can get it on YouTube, right? The whole documentary, right? Where he tried to expose, you know, contemporary art as con art, as fraudulent. So we have lost one of the you know, staunchest critics of contemporary art. But there are still critics like the Stuckies. Okay, the Stuckies are this, it's an international art group or movement, okay, that try to promote figurative art. Okay, and you know, and they are very critical of, you know, unconventional art like conceptual art. Okay, and they are the staunchest critics of the Turner Prize. Okay, so when the Turner Prize comes around, okay, they'll be around. Okay, as you can see there, protesting, demonstrating. All right. But let me, I suppose, you know, let me pull on my hat and you know, sort of try to make you understand, you know, appreciate maybe contemporary art better. Okay. You know, contemporary art, I would say, move away from the idea of art as a commodity. Right? Because contemporary art often, for example, takes place outside the museum or gallery. Okay? And, you know, some artists are, in a sense, they are in a way anti-commercial. Okay? So, in order for their works not to be a commodity, what happens is that, you know, they would resort to unconventional art forms like performance art, okay, or installation art. Now these art forms are always very temporary, very ephemeral, okay. And once the performance or installation, you know, is over, that's it. All right, you can't sell the work. Right? Actually, you can, but you know, normally in performance art, now you actually sell the photographs or the performance, okay. But in a sense, you cannot sell the work itself. Right, like you can do with a painting or sculpture. And forms of contemporary are diverse, some of which have no historical precedence. Right? So we need to also be mindful of that. Okay, as I mentioned before, the artists are constantly trying to challenge the mainstream. Right? And they are using more and more unconventional approaches to making art, okay, including unconventional materials. So keep your eye out, you know, I mean, you know, what's next for artists, you know? Right? Okay, there's always something that is unconventional going on. Perhaps when you visit Singapore Biennale 2013, right? Okay, you'll find some of these works there. Use of non-art materials. Okay, I think that's linked to the second point. Artistic materials, that we are familiar with. Okay, right? Like for sculpture, it's like clay and marble, etc. Okay, non-art materials will include something like maybe that, what is that, Wrigley's, I don't know what material that's made of, but I suppose,
Fiber.
Oh, fiber, yeah, fiber, yeah. Okay, so fiber, I suppose, is a non-art material, in a way, right? Okay. But of course, I've already shown you examples of non-art materials, right? The excrement and the blood, and fluids. There's an emphasis on process and concept, and I think we have to understand this, okay, that sometimes artists not only want to draw attention to the concept of the work, the idea, the big idea, but also to the process of the work. Okay, so sometimes when you focus on the process of the work may not look very interesting. Okay, and it is becoming increasingly what you call relational. There's this word now you call relational aesthetics, right? Relational art. Is where artists actually collaborate with people, with the public, right, in making that work of art. I'll show you one or two examples later. And as I said, again, coming back to the spectacle, right, contemporary art thrives on the spectacle. It's spectacular, right, in normally in its size, okay, in its skill. And it's sometimes displayed outside the museum or gallery. Okay, much of contemporary art is also site-specific. Okay, meaning to say that it makes use of a particular site. Right? Okay, I mean in the 70s you have this group of artists called environmental artists in America. People like Robert Smithson, Christo. Okay, and they created works out of doors. Okay, making use of natural materials. Okay, I mean, Smithson is famous for his spiral jetty, right? Okay, and it does not display skills that we traditionally associate with art. Right. So, I suppose the skills are used in a different way, in a different manner. Okay, not the kind of craft-like skills that we associate with with a lot of pre-modern or even modern art. Okay. And lastly, we have to understand that contemporary art reflects much of the social, economic, political context of its time. Now, one example of what you call relational art, okay, is this work done by Amanda Heng. How many of you know Amanda Heng? Oh, good. A handful, right? But not bad. I think the rest of us should know Amanda Heng, right? I mean, as Singaporeans, we should at least know our own artists. And she's one of our most prominent, okay, artists, right? And certainly one of the most famous performance artists, okay. But her works also deal a lot with feminist issues as well, right? And for this particular work, all right, it was first performed in the substation. Okay, the substation is in Armenian Street, okay, where Amanda Heng got this table, and then she would invite people to sit with her around this table. And what did they do? Pluck taugeh. Taugeh are bean sprouts, right? Or what you call clean, right? Clean the bean sprouts. Drink tea. Engage in conversation, probably about art and about life. Right? Okay, and why does she do that? Okay, in a sense, she wanted to, I suppose, recapture. Okay, it was, in a way, it's nostalgic, the work. Okay, she wanted to capture a lost time, okay, where people used to sit down, okay, and engage in conversation. Okay, and where such a simple domestic activity can become a nexus for social interaction. Okay, and today, people are too busy to talk to each other, right? Okay, so that could be, that could be one of the kind of interpretation of this work. I think this work was shown at a museum, right? Singapore Museum. where, you know, the artist is not there, but you can, of course, you know, sit around and create your own artwork, I suppose. Okay? So as you sit around, you pluck the tauges and you talk to each other, that's the artwork. And later on, this work was performed in several other countries like Japan, right? I think in Japan it was performed in a mall, right? Again, in a couple of other countries. Now, what makes this art? Okay, I don't know whether you're here for my, I think this was, I showed this in the first lecture, okay, whether any of you can recall. Okay, it's a work by Tracy Emin, okay, who was a member of the Young British Artists. Okay, and this work is entitled My Bed. Yes, it's her bed. Okay, it's Tracy Emin's bed. The bed which she slept on, where she probably experienced a depression in, okay, and did a whole lot of other things on it. Okay, and you'll see strewn on the ground, okay, are all sorts of paraphernalia, rubbish, cigarettes, condoms, soiled knickers, right, etc. Okay. Do you call this art? Okay. But again, you know, to understand such a work, we have to again understand a little bit about the artist, okay, the artist's philosophy, intention. And for Tracy Emin, her works are very autobiographical. Okay, right? And you know, through her works, she wants people to know, to in a sense, give people a kind of a doorway into her own life and experiences. And she actually experienced a very traumatic, you know, life. You know, I think she was raped twice and all that, okay, among other things. Okay. But she's very notorious, right? She won't hesitate, for example, to use four-letter words, you know, on camera, right? Jeff Koons, talking about Jeff Koons, you know, right? Okay, this is actually one of his earliest works. This was done, I think, in the 1980s. Okay. I think both his art and his personal life were very controversial, right? He was the one who married the Italian porn star, okay, who later became an MP. Okay. And they did a series of very pornographic, right, series of pornographic photographs called Made in Heaven. Okay, but anyway, for this work, okay, all he did was he displayed vacuum cleaners within some plexiglass. Right? You know, I think some of you are already laughing. But you have to understand, again, as I said, it's important to understand, you know, perhaps the artist's intention. Okay, and what makes such works art? And not some product in like Harvey Norman. Okay? First and foremost, you know, I mean, you know, this work, I think, attracts or appeals simply because of its newness, right? It looks in pristine quality, okay? And that sort of seductive quality of the work is enhanced by the fluorescent lights, okay? It's illuminated by the fluorescent lights, okay? And also the fact that, you know, there's no way for you to touch the work, okay? So all this tells you that, yes, you know, and it distinguishes this work from a mere commodity. And that's what perhaps makes this work art. But then you ask yourself, so what? You know? What does he want to convey with, you know, with vacuum cleaners? But again, that's interesting because, again, it's art perhaps to our interpretation. Okay? Is he trying to criticize consumer culture? Right? Or is he trying to celebrate consumer culture? Is he trying to say how we transfer our fantasies and our desires to ordinary objects like this? Right? Is he talking about the manipulation of ownership and desire, let's say through advertising or through advertisements? Okay, so all these, as I said, are possibilities for interpreting the work. Now, in case, you know, you're still not convinced, you know, right? You know, what makes a work art, or what makes like Tracy Emin's My Bed art, or Jeff Koons vacuum cleaners art. Okay, and you know, this a person called George Dickey. Okay. He formulated this theory called the institutional theory of art. Okay. And the institutional theory of art, okay, tries, I suppose, to justify many of the things you see today as art. Okay. Right. So what makes my bed art, for example? Okay. Firstly, is the artist's intention. Okay. That art can be what the artist and the art world say it is. Okay, firstly, the artist must say that it is art. Okay, so the artist's intention is paramount. And secondly, the art world says so. Okay? So there are certain influential people in the art world, like curators, art critics, okay, I suppose gallery owners, like Jazz, right? Or Suping, right? You know, they have the right, the capacity to confer the status of artwork on any object, right? Okay, so what I'm trying to say is that, you know, in a sense, all these people in the art world, they have the capacity to sanction a particular work as a work of art, okay? And also, a work can gain status, artistic status, simply by being displayed in a certain context. Right? So if my bed is displayed in a gallery or museum, by virtue of that, it is art. That makes the work art. Okay? I know some of you are still looking baffled and, you know, bewildered. So if you think that, like me, you can become an artist, right? Okay, you can, but you must have your work displayed in a certain context, right? And sanctioned, okay, by certain groups of people. Okay, but as I said, it all boils down to a matter of interpretation, right? I like this quote by Philip Yanawine. Okay, his book also is a very interesting book. If you want to try to understand modern art, okay, I strongly recommend you to purchase his book, right? How to Look at Modern Art. Okay. And I just want to draw attention to the underlying sentences, where he says that, you know, art is really a game of speculation and interpretation. Okay, since absolute right or wrong answers do not exist. So, is that the case that, you know, then that anything goes, even in terms of interpretation, that anyone can say that, you know, say anything and, you know, and you cannot refute that person? I suppose to some extent, you know, yes. Right? But as I said, you know, when you want to offer an interpretation, okay, it must sound convincing, right? You have to, I suppose, justify why you say something. Okay, but I suppose you have the right, you know, to interpret that work in the way you see fit. Okay, I think this was an exhibition that was that took place, I think, last year. Okay, last year, right? It was at the Singapore Art Museum. It's called Not Against Interpretation. Right, it's actually a restaging of two artists' work. Okay, but the whole idea of this exhibition is to leave the viewer to interpret the work. I think now there's a similar exhibition going on. Okay, it's called Untitled. Okay, where you know, it leaves it. You know, it leaves the, I think the one can, do you know anything about it? The Untitled. Are there captions to the work? Oh, so there are no title, and you are sort of no title, right? You are encouraged to, right, give the title to the work. Okay, so you know, the museum is trying to do all this, you know, because you know, from their point of view, you know, contemporary art is very much open-ended. So how do we look at contemporary art, right? It is wide-ranging, it's very inclusive, as I say, diverse. Okay, so we have to remember that, you know, art has long since to be just about mere appearance, or simply about an imitation of nature or copying of nature. Okay? It is now about other things. Right? So you can look at, you know, contemporary art from other perspectives. Okay, like the scale of the work, the quality, the effort of its construction, for example. Right? Or you can look at the kind of originality of its concept or idea. Okay? Rather than simply focusing on the aesthetic quality of the work or the skill of the artist. Okay, and we have to understand also that judgments and ideas about art change over time. Right? It changes over time. And artists are simply responding to the times in which they live in, their society. Okay? So we are living in a very connected age, right? Okay, you have Facebook and Twitter and all that, new media. Okay, and you know, if you look at some contemporary artists, they are using all this medium in their work as well. Right? Okay, so you have to understand that their work evolves, right, in response to the artist's own environment and society. Okay, before I this is a work by the Chinese contemporary artist Zhang Huan. And Zhang Huan, you know, he belonged to this group of artists that practiced in what they call the East Village in Beijing. And this group of artists, were quite extreme in their performances, right? Okay, but this is a little tamer, right? This particular work. Okay, but again, this is an example of a relational art. Okay, but it's also a performance art piece as well. Okay, where the artist actually got this group of people, right? They are actually itinerant, illegal migrant workers, right? And he actually got them to go into a fish pond. And as they went into the fish pond, it raises the water level by about 1 meter. Okay? Now you may ask yourself, what is all this about? Okay, because in China, you know, there are cases where, you know, rural workers will go to the urban centers to work in the factories and construction. Okay? And often these people have no voice at all. In fact, they are often outside the government's radar. Okay? And so by doing this, the artist is trying to draw our attention to the plight of these workers and also to give weight and voice, right, to this otherwise voiceless, you know, group of people. Right? So I think this work gives the phrase floating, what do you call that? Floating, slipped my mind now. Right? Floating population? No. Okay. You'll come back to me, okay? Okay, before I end, I think it's important to try to understand the three major art forms today, all right? And we're going to look at installation art, performance art, and video art, right? Now, installation art, okay, I've shown you some examples of installation art. Okay, and installation art is an art form that normally takes place in a very immersive environment. Okay, meaning to say that it can occupy a whole room by itself. Okay, and when you enter into that space, the viewer enters into that space, you're actually standing inside the artwork. Okay, and you actually become part of the artwork. Right, and entering into that space also activates a certain response in you. Right? So unlike looking at a piece of sculpture or painting, right, installation art forces you to look at the work from all points of view. Okay? It is normally a very interactive, right? It normally also evokes or provokes a multi-sensory experience. Okay? It could involve, for example, smell, okay? Right, and you know, the other sort of sensorial experiences, and it normally combines composite media. So an installation work can combine, for example, painting with sculpture, or painting with found objects or ready-mades, okay, or painting or sculpture with video, for example. Okay, so it combines. And the thing with installation art is that it normally provokes various or varied interpretations. Okay, you can In fact, I think that's what makes it interesting, where you know you can interpret it, right? However you see fit. Okay. Okay, and also the kind of immediacy of the work, okay, and the transient experience of the work demands our sort of participation, our active participation. Okay, meaning to say that installation art is also relational, it's interactive. Right? It forces you to interact with it. Right? And also it's temporal and ephemeral. Okay, often when you know the exhibition is over, that's it. The work no longer, theoretically no longer exists. But having said that, you know, the artist can always recreate the work. Okay, but that's another topic. Is it the same anymore, right? If the artist recreate the work. Now, this is an example of an installation work, right? It's by the husband and wife team. Okay, they are Filipinos. Okay, originally from the Philippines, and then they migrated to Australia. Okay, Isabel and Alfredo Aquilizan. And this work was shown in the second Singapore Biennale. I don't know whether some of you recall. Okay, and when you enter this space, right, you'll see this installation, which actually takes the shape of what you call the balik bayan boxes. You know, these are crates or boxes where, you know, when Filipinos migrate, you know, they will put their stuff in. Okay. You can see that he has created you know, smaller sort of balik bayan crates, you know, to serve as molds for the work. Okay. And he has filled them up with items and objects donated, okay, by Filipinos. So their work often involves working with the community as well. Right? And in a larger context, right, this work speaks of things like migration, dislocation, memory, you know, as you migrate to another country. So this is an example of installation work where it forces you as well to, you know, to move around the space and to interact with the work. Jeffrey, yes.
Then what makes your presentation here not an installation art piece?
Oh wow. Okay. My talk.
Yes. Why right. Is it not an art piece? You just need somebody who said it is an art piece.
Wow, that's too profound for me at the moment. Maybe I'll try to attempt to, you know, answer that, you know. And then, or maybe talk to you in person later. Do you understand his question? You know,
right?
I'm not in the right context. Yeah, perhaps. Thanks for you know saving me. I never considered my sort of talk to be you know to be a work of art. You know, it's different. You
because
know,
the artist's intention is of specific intention, and its delivery is of delivery. Everyone is here in a specific
right
purpose.
Right.
So it does fit into the description.
Well said, I think, yeah. I mean, if you look at it that way, you know, perhaps, yeah. Thanks for provoking, you know, our thoughts. And this work, you know, this work is a seminal work, right? Okay, it's one of the most famous, you know, installation art, you know, ever created. Okay, Richard Wilson's 2050. Okay, now imagine yourself, you know, entering this space, and then you have to walk through this metal, this tapering metal trough, right? Okay, and as you walk, even when you enter the space, you know, it sort of already engages your senses, especially the sense of smell, and maybe sight as well. Okay, it smells like petroleum. Okay, right? So you walk in, you walk along this metal trough, you come to the end, and at the end, you look down. Okay. Now, as you look down, you see, you know, a reflection, right? And a reflection of the walls and the doors of the space, right? And then you realize that, you know, in fact, I'm not sure whether it's half or one third, okay? But part of the gallery itself, right, is filled with some oil. SUMP, right? Some oil, I think, is like petroleum. Okay, and so this is one example of a very immersive work. Right? It occupies the whole space, right? It sort of engages not only your senses, but your kind of your your physiology. It's a physiological experience. Because when you look down, okay, with the smell and all that, you know, it creates a kind of a stupor, you know, sometimes you can, you know, right? And but at the same time, is if you can't appreciate that, then you can appreciate the kind of the formal qualities of the work, the scale of the work, the configuration, right? And, you know, this whole question of how did the artist do it, right? How did he get the oil into the gallery, okay? And what's the depth of the oil? Okay, now the title of the work refers to the viscosity of the oil, 2050. Okay, but again, you know, with works like that, you always want to ask, what's the point? What's the meaning of this work? Okay, what's the significance of oil? Again, that's really open-ended. Okay, you can actually interpret it and ask yourself why the artist actually used oil. Okay, right? Is he talking about the Middle East? You know, and all the conflicts there, for example. In fact, one person came to this space, you know, and looked down and thought that there's another space there, you know, below. Okay. Because technically, it's so, you know, it's so well done. Okay, two more to go. Just to talk about performance art. Okay. Now, installation art, I suppose, is still quite accessible, right? Okay, because sometimes it uses forms that you can recognize, right? Like painting, you know, and sometimes sculpture. But with performance art, you know, it gets a bit more difficult. Okay, where the artist? Maybe now I'm doing a performance. Are you saying that? I don't know. You know, I have to think about that a bit. Where, firstly, you know, the work of art takes place in real time and space. Real time and space. Okay? And the artist and his body becomes, and his actions as well, become the work of art. Okay? So I suppose, you know, performance art is very direct, right? It's very physical as well, right? So it engages our expectations in ways that other art forms cannot engage, right? And because by nature, performance art, you know, is against conventional practices, okay, normally takes place outside a museum context. Okay? Now, don't get performance art mixed up with performing arts or even with theatre. Okay, because performance art is not theater, although it has some theatrical elements, okay, like the performance, the artist, you know, sort of acting out, okay. But other than that, you know, there are very few similarities. Okay, for example, performance art normally does not follow a script, although it can be scripted. Okay, it does not have a kind of a plot. Okay, sometimes it is wholly incomprehensible. Okay, you don't know what is going on. Okay, and it also invites viewer participation. Okay, in fact, it requires the audience, the viewer, to complete the work itself. Okay, without the audience, you know, there's no artwork. Okay, and again, the artist's intention are paramount. Okay, you have to understand this, and you know, you have to ask yourself, why didn't the artist use another art form to communicate? Okay, because probably he finds this art form to be the most effective in realizing his intentions or her intentions. Okay. Now, do I have examples? Yes. Okay. Another Singaporean artist you have to know. Okay. So you know already one, or you learned one today, Amanda Heng. Okay. This is another performance artist, famous performance artist, one of our more prominent performers, Lee Wen. And now Lee Wen is, of course, you know, today, unfortunately, you know, you meet Lee Wen, you know, he's suffering from Parkinson's disease, and you know, his performance is now very limited. I don't think he's doing any work, right? Okay. But I think he's most famous for his what you call his Yellow Man series, okay, where he actually takes on this persona of, you know, of a man who is covered in yellow paint. Right, and then he would perform this in various cities. He would walk along the streets and all that. Okay, So by doing that, by painting himself yellow, okay, he's actually trying to exaggerate his ethnicity, right? His ethnicity of being a Singaporean of Chinese descent, okay, right? But I think at the same time, rather than trying to affirm his ethnicity, okay, he is destabilizing all these ethnic categories, right? Okay, meaning to say that perhaps identity is never fixed. Okay, because what happened is that when he performed this in different contexts, in different countries, all right, by doing that, he actually tests, cultural assumptions regarding race and ethnicity. Okay, so for example, if this work was performed in India, okay, the color yellow is associated, for example, with monastic, the monastic community, the monks and all that. Okay, when it's performed in Australia, for example, okay, the color yellow may take on the meaning of, maybe associated with racism. Okay, and in Singapore, it's the other way around, it may be associated with multiculturalism, right? So can you see that? Okay, so he tests our own assumptions about about ethnic categories. Okay, and by doing that, I think raise awareness also, about the racial and ethnic stereotypes, right? Okay, and now this is a very this is the third artist you have to know, okay, right? This person you have to know. Tang Dawu. Have you heard of Tang Dawu? Right, I think, right? Okay, some of you have, nodding your head. Okay. Now, Tang Dawu, he's a seminal figure, no doubt, in the contemporary art of Singapore. Right, and some say he actually, was the one who really, whose practices marked the beginnings of contemporary art. Okay, I wouldn't give all the credit to him because there were a couple of people before him, right, who have already done that, but but through the founding of this art group called the Artist Village, or TAV for short, okay, his contribution to the Singapore art scene was aged, right? And the Artist Village was a group of young artists, okay, who began to create experimental art forms. So you want to know the beginnings of performance art, installation art, okay, etc. You have to go back, right, to the history of the Artist Village. Okay, and Tang Dawu was the leader of that collective. Okay. And they actually rented, they stayed together, in Ulu Sembawang, right, among the chicken coops and all that. Okay, for a while at least. Right. And Tang Dawu, he did this performance, a very seminal performance. Again, as I said, when you look at performance art, you don't expect to see any narrative, any plot, right? Okay, sometimes you don't know what is happening. Okay, but through the series of ritualistic gestures and action, the artist is trying to convey a certain message as well. Okay, so for this performance called Tiger Sweep, he created 10 life-size papier-mâché tigers. Okay, and he also brought in some other objects, I think like a bed, a basketball, right, a rocking chair, right, and he would take on the role. Normally performance art is performed by simply one artist. Okay, so Tang Dawu would take on the role of the tiger spirit, the patrons who frequented prostitutes. Now, the context of this performance is also important because it took place in Keong Sak Road in Chinatown. As you know, Keong Sak Road is notorious or famous for its prostitution, especially with elderly men. Okay. And so hence the rocking chair. Okay, because the rocking chair is, not only rocks and the rocking sort of, simulates, the sexual act, but it also represents the elderly man who frequented the prostitutes there. Okay. And on the rocking chair itself is, it's a drawing of a phallus. All right. So this whole work is talking about the tiger's, the word whip itself refers to the tiger's penis. Okay. So Tang Dawu, his works deal a lot with environmental issues as well. And he wants to draw attention to the fact that, we are appropriating, right, the tiger's, you know, private parts, right, for our own sexual gratification as aphrodisiacs. Okay, lastly, actually I'm going to show you a very short video right after this. Okay, it's an interesting video. Now, I find video art to be the most challenging of contemporary art forms. Okay, and I mean, film video art now, they are normally put together in the same sort of genre. And, you know, artists started to use the video and television as a medium from the 1960s onwards. Okay. And what makes video art so frustrating is that artists use a familiar medium, right, in a very unfamiliar way. Right? It subverts all our expectations about what video is, right? About what television is. And you know, and it started with this very famous Korean American video artist called Nam June Park. Okay. Who practiced in the 1960s, okay, Nam June Park. And you know, Nam June Park would, you know, one of his strategies was to, visual strategy was to distort the images on the television monitors that he used in his work, right? Okay, because we are always seen as passive receivers, right, or messages, right, on the TV. Okay, and so in a sense, many of these artists wanted to subvert that kind of control, you know, by corporations or by certain groups of people, right? And again, put that power back in the individual, right, through their works. Now, again, you know, video art is nothing like, as I said, conventional television or films, right, or videos. Okay, that essentially there's no narrative. If there's any narrative at all, it's normally incomprehensible. Okay, it's not concerned with entertainment, right, in the conventional sense. Although you can sit there with your popcorn and eat and watch at the same time, right? Okay, but the challenging part about, again, talking about watching, you know, about video art is that it wouldn't last. Sometimes it lasts at most about 20 minutes, but often we only stay there like for a minute. Okay, and if you stay there for a minute, you can't, you know, you cannot have the full appreciation of that work. Right? You have to stay for the duration, right, of you know, of that work. I just heard that, you know, people, audiences in Japan do that, you know, right? Okay, they stay for the whole day, but not Singaporeans. Okay. I have to admit I'm one of them as well. Okay. I find it a challenge as well to understand you know, video art. Okay, because essentially there's no drama, no plot, okay, no linear narrative. Okay, very minimal character development, right? You know, often it also subverts our own notions of time and space, you know. It's normally played in slow motion or in loops, okay? So there's one work, I can't remember, Gordon Douglas is the name of the artist, or the other way around. Okay, created this work called 24-Hour Psycho. Now, do you know Alfred Hitchcock Classic Psycho? Okay, now it slowed down, yeah, it slowed down the whole picture, okay, so much so that you need 24 hours to view it. Imagine. Now, who will stay for 24 hours, right? Okay. And also you know, there's also no like sophisticated camera work. Okay. Normally, the camera is just a fix, you know, the one spot and things like that. Okay. So I'm just gonna maybe screen the video and. Maybe before doing that, you know, just let me conclude. Okay, I'm done, and I've included some tips for looking at contemporary art. Right, and I would say that you know, the title is important still. Although many artists refrain from attaching a title to their work because they don't want their works to be too prescriptive. Right, that's one reason, or maybe they can't think of a title. Right, that's another reason. Okay, but if there's a title, there's a caption. Read the title. Right? And if there's any text, read the text. It might give you clue to the work. Okay? And also materials, right? What materials did the artist use and how does that affect the content of the work? Okay, that's also important to think about. And also do some research on the artist. Right? I mean, if you see the artist for the first time, you know, go back, do some research. So the next time you see the artist's work, okay, you'll be probably be able to know the kind of theme that the artist deals with in his work, right? And space as well is very important. How does space contribute to the understanding of the work? Okay, and etc. And lastly, there's no such thing as a wrong interpretation, but there's such a thing as a convincing interpretation. Okay, let me show you the video. It's a short video, so don't worry.
Do you want to watch the other one as well?
No, maybe just this one.
Yeah?
Yeah, sorry. Okay. Okay, to give you a further clue, the music is Gregorio Allegri's, you know, Have Mercy on Me, O Lord. Okay, and the title of this song is Threshold to the Kingdom. Okay, I won't bore you with the rest of it. Okay, thanks. Okay, but, okay. Seriously, this is an example of video art. Okay, I mean, it has all the, you know, the characteristics that I mentioned before, right? Okay, I mean, it subverts conventional time. You know, there's really no, you know, it's shown in slow motion. There's really no drama or action. Okay, all you see are people walking out of this automatic door, right? You know, and walking rather weightlessly. And then you have a person sitting there on the left. He's like, I suppose, a security guard. Okay, and the potted plants. Okay, right? Yes, and there's almost no narrative. Okay, but and because of that, you know, this whole video can be just seen as people watching. You know, it's like a documentary. You know, okay, and that itself, I think, can be quite interesting, right? You anticipate, you know, it's in anticipation of the next person walking in and how he or she looks like, right? Okay, and all that. So you can see the people walking in, you know, some of them look apprehensive, some relief, some weary, some are on the lookout for their, I suppose, their relatives and friends, right? Okay, but, I mean, looking at the title, as I said, you know, just what I say, sometimes you need to look at the title, and then also the music that's played, the choral music, right? Now, can anyone tell me, you know, perhaps what do you think this, you know, whole work, you know, what's the whole idea behind this work?
Spiritual.
Okay, so can you maybe elaborate further?
I think it's talking about the heaven, the gates of heaven.
Okay.
Where you walk through it, and people, when they enter through the gates, it's a kind of look, and that the automated door is the gate of heaven.
Precisely. And who's the person on the left? Okay, so you can see it as St. Peter. Okay, because St. Peter is the one who holds the key to the kingdom of heaven. Yes. Okay, so the music, the kind of the weightless, you know, right? You know, the people walking out witlessly, you know? Yes, you're right, you know? I mean, that's one interpretation at least. And I think that's what the artist is also trying to say about this work, right? Okay, and the work itself, kingdom. I mean, kingdom can be United Kingdom, but it can also be, you know, a play of word. It can also be the kingdom of heaven, right? Okay, right. So you can see now. I mean, of course, it's not very interesting to look at, but you know, sometimes we have to again to understand, you know, what the artist is trying to say in this work, right? Okay. Now, any other? Maybe we can take one or two other questions. Yeah, a bit soft, yeah.
I'm just curious, right? Like, in the filming of this, if we were the audience actually watching the film itself, would it then be a form of performance art as well? Like, what separates the audience who watches it live versus the audience that watches the film recording of the performance?
Right. Okay, I'm trying to digest what you said. Okay. Whether this can be considered, you think, to be a...
If you watch it live, right, would it be considered performance art? Or does it have to be on film before it's considered performance art?
Oh, yes. Normally, performance art is an art form where the artist himself performs live. Okay, and normally it just merely involves the artist and not other people. Okay, but there are, of course, other... performances which are actually shown through video feeds, you know, like some of the surgical performances of Orlan. Orlan is the French artist who actually undergoes live surgery, okay, to make herself up as famous, the characters in the works of famous artists, you know, right? And you can see all the blood there's, you know, as the doctor operates upon her and things like that. Yeah. Okay, but this is clearly a video work, okay, because the artist is using the medium of video and all that. But I mean, you can look at it, I suppose there are some performative elements, you know, in it as well.
What makes art, one of the definitions of what makes art is the artist's intention.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Then why would contemporary art be so difficult to understand if it's about the artist's intention? So there would be a description of the artwork, and whether you agree with it is a different point.
You see, again, talking about the artist, you got her question, right? Again, that is exactly the intention of the artist, you know? Because some artists want to make their work deliberately incomprehensible and opaque. Right? Okay? And yes, right? I don't know why they do that, but yes, you know? Maybe they want to leave their work a bit more open-ended, I suppose. Right? Okay? And so, again, the question is, do you take the artist's intention at face value again? Right? Okay? Because I don't know who was saying, Roy Lichtenstein, who says, you know, do not believe in all that I say because, you know, right? So the artist's intention, is it really paramount? Right? So I suppose you can always use your own interpretation when looking at a work of art, okay? Despite what the artist say or despite the artist's intention. Hope that understands your...
But then it's not defined as art, right? Because you define it as art based on your intention.
Precisely. But if you look at George Dickey's, you know, I have to invoke George Dickey's theory of, yeah, you know, when it's displayed in a certain context, then that's what also makes the work art.
That's
one of it, yeah. Okay. Good. Today's audience is quite very interactive.
Okay. I have a question with regards to the performance art for the title week. The title week performance.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. So when again, it feels very positive. It's a little bit like contemporary theatre. I don't really see the distinction as much. Like the performative and emphasis is very strong in that one, but yeah, as compared to other performance art instead. So what is the distinction for that work?
I don't know whether you have watched a theatre before, right? Anyone has watched? Of course, you've been to to watch like Wild Rice Productions and all that, right? Okay, even those forum theatres. I mean, You know, I mean, there's a difference. Have you seen a performance art yourself? Oh, okay.
Ah.
On video, right? Okay, I think it's also important to see it, you know, in person. And you can certainly see the distinct differences between a performance art and, let's say, a theatrical work, right? Because, you know, as I said before, you know, in performance art, normally you only have, I mean, even in theater you can have a monologue, you know, just one artist, right? But other than that, there's really no narrative, no linear narrative, okay? There's no character development, no plot, right? The artists normally don't dress up in, theatrical costumes, for example, right? There's no sophisticated camera work, okay, as you see in Mark Wallinger's piece, right? Okay, so I think all this sets performance art apart from performing art. Okay, now of course, paramount to it is the artist's intention as well. Okay, right.
And it often involves the audience.
Oh, yeah. And it often involves the audience as well. Right. Okay. I think that's a good point. Mm. I mean, Marina, what's that? Abramovich, right? Marina Abramovich, right? Performance artist. I mean, she did a show in MoMA, I believe, called The Artist Is Not Present. Okay, where she was sitting in a chair, and I think I don't know how many hundreds of people came and sat opposite her. Okay, and some people actually broke down and cried. You know, okay. You know, so that's the kind, you know, right? It's relational and it's also performative in a sense. Okay, if there are no further questions, thank you very much.